Well, Merry Christmas. So good to have you all here. Those of you watching online, we're so glad that you could join us today and be a part of our Christmas celebration. Man, didn't the band do an incredible job of bringing us to this point? I checked the cajon. There was smoke coming out of it afterwards, so I don't know. John was going to town. He did a great job, too. Kids, you did a great job. We loved hearing you sing. I'm curious, how many of you kids are ready for Christmas? Just a couple? Man, there's no energy right now. You should have seen our house all day. There was energy bouncing off the walls. And then you come and ask them in front of people and they won't say anything. Kids, you know, normally we don't talk in adult church, but we're going to let you talk today because it's a special time. I'm going to ask you to shout out what you're asking for, what you're hoping for Christmas on the count of three. You ready? One, two, three. Oh my goodness. Wow, there was some energy there, right? I mean, they brought it out for that. Man, well, I hope that you are pleasantly surprised tomorrow and that you receive something that you are hoping for. So years ago when I was a kid, we got a gift that my brothers and I got a gift that we weren't hoping for. We didn't even know to hope for it, but we were pretty excited when we got it. And it was a Sega Master System. Does anybody know what a Sega Master System is? Two people. Okay, well, this was back in the day when there was the NES, the original Nintendo. Anybody know the NES? Some of you had that, right? So the Sega Master System was the counterpart. So instead of Super Mario World, we had Alex Kidd in Miracle World, which was, similar. And, you know, it was back in the day where the controllers just had two buttons, when people like myself were actually able to play instead of the ones that have 15 buttons and you have no idea what to do. And so it was just great. We were so excited. We loved it. And there was something about those old video game systems. Those of you who are older and who had them, you know what I'm going to talk about. They had cartridges. Remember that? They're like these big brick-type things that you would put into the game system, and it had the game on it, because this is before Al Gore invented the internet for us. And so we couldn't download games from the internet. We had to have these cartridges. You could go to places like Blockbuster, ask your parents what that is, and you could go to Blockbuster and rent a video game. And the Sega Master System had one thing over the Nintendo, because those of you who had a Nintendo know what the problem was. Every once in a while, you would put the cartridge in, and it wouldn't work. Remember that? And you had to pull it out, and you had to blow in it, and you had to hope and pray, and you stuck it back in, and you pushed the reset button, and you would, fingers crossed, hope that the game would start up, and every once in a while, it would work. Every once in a while, it would not. And I got to thinking about it. You know, how many of you feel like you wish you could do that with the year 2020? Like, could we just take the cartridge out, blow in it, put it back in, and hit the reset button and, like, redo it? Oh, my goodness, what a year it has been. It's been a hard year. It's been a challenging year. It's been a frustrating year, maybe a disappointing year. In fact, my guess is, as you think about 2020, there are some hopes that have been unmet for you. In fact, the definition of a hope is just, it's an expectation. It's something that you expect to happen. And there are probably some hopes that were unmet that you didn't even know were hopes. Like walking around without masks on everywhere, right? You didn't even know you hoped to do that. And yet, you did. And that was a hope that was unmet. Sometimes there are weddings that were canceled, or they changed, or the number of people being able to be there changed, or they were delayed. There are vacations that were postponed or canceled. Kids being in school. How many of you hoped your kids would be in school, but you became homeschool teachers unexpectedly in a very short period of time? I mean, there are all kinds of hopes that we have. And the thing is, when our expectations and when our hopes aren't met, there's a temptation within us to kind of begin to despair. We question. When our hopes don't come to fruition, we question and we begin to wonder what it is that we can actually lean on. And we begin to wonder, is there anything that we can actually hope in anymore? Because so many things have let us down. So many things that we depended on or expected to happen and take place didn't happen and take place. And so it can lead us to despair. My guess is in the last year, you have felt more frustration. You have felt more unsettled. You have felt perhaps more unhappy, perhaps you felt more lonely and even hopeless. wondering where God is, wondering how God is going to show up, wondering what God is doing in the midst of all that's taking place. And you know what's interesting is that what we've experienced in the last year to a far lesser degree isn't altogether different than what people were experiencing 2,000 years ago when the miracle that we celebrate at Christmas was taking place. There was a group of people who were hopeless, who were wondering, who were waiting. The nation of Israel was a nation that in many regards was met with frustration and sadness. They went from a great king, David, and his son, Solomon, and then it kind of went downhill from there for the nation. There was a period of time where they were actually put in exile. They were taken into captivity. And it was during this kind of upheaval and the questioning and the wondering of where God is, there's a prophet who spoke, and his name was Isaiah, and he was speaking and prophesying about a coming Messiah. And take a look at what the prophet Isaiah spoke. And again, he's speaking as the Messiah. He says, "He has anointed me," that's the Messiah, "He has anointed me, the Messiah, to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to repair broken hearts." In other words, for those who are overwhelmed, for those who are frustrated, for those who have had unmet expectations, for those who find themselves hopeless, whose dreams haven't come true, I am here to repair their broken hearts. He goes on, he says, "For those who mourn, it will be a time of comfort. As for those who grieve," if you've grieved anything over the last year, pay attention. He says, "As for those who grieve, God has sent me to give them a beautiful crown in exchange for ashes, to anoint them with gladness instead of sorrow, to wrap them in victory, joy, and praise instead of depression and sadness." In other words, hope is coming to a weary world. A weary world that is wondering how much longer it can hold on. You know, what's interesting is the nation of Israel had to hold on for quite a while. In fact, it was roughly 700 years where they sat waiting and wondering and hoping and waiting and wondering and hoping. And then one day, in the most unexpected way, at the most unexpected place, to the most unexpected person, an angel came. And the angel spoke to Mary. Here's what Luke records. You're probably familiar with this. Luke says, "The angel went to her and said, 'Greetings, you who are highly favored.' He said, 'The Lord is with you.'" To which Mary must have been wondering, if the Lord is with us, why? Why the oppression? Because the Israelites were subject to Rome. I mean, they were under Roman oppression and occupation. Why? If God is with us, why is this hard thing happening to us? And yet the angel told her to fear not, because God was moving. Hope was dawning. Light was about to enter into the darkness. And soon after that, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census would be taken of the Roman world. And Mary and her betrothed, Joseph, they traveled to Bethlehem for the census, and there a baby was born, but not just a baby, the baby who would be born, king, king of the world. He didn't come to conquer kingdoms, though. He came to invade hearts and to restore hope to those who were weary. And an angel went out into the hillsides where shepherds were watching their flocks, and the angel spoke to the flocks and said, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And the shepherds traveled to Bethlehem looking, wondering, hoping. And their hope wasn't disappointed as they looked at the baby who had been born. Now, 40 days after Jesus was born, his parents took him to the temple to present him there. And at the temple, there was a man named Simeon who was older in age. And Simeon had been waiting his entire life to see the Messiah. He had this expectation. He'd been told. In fact, here's what Luke tells us, that it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. He had hope coming. And finally, when Jesus was presented to him, he had the privilege of looking hope in the eyes. I can't imagine what he was thinking. Maybe something similar to what you and I think and we wonder when we wonder about hope. But he cried out to God. Here's what he said. He says, "Sovereign Lord, Sovereign Lord, which is God who created the sun, the moon, the stars, and the universe and everything in it. He said, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. My hope wasn't in vain, he says. For my eyes have seen your salvation. I have looked hope in the eyes, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. In other words, I have seen hope born for all people. Hope isn't lost. Hope isn't lost. We can relate to that, can't we? In a year where so many of us have felt hope was lost, when so many of us have felt disappointment and grief and suffering and sorrow. Just as Simeon was there, there was another woman whose name was Anna, and Anna had been a widow for seemingly nearly 100 years. After 7 years of marriage, her husband died, and she went to the temple and worshiped God day after day after day, and she had the privilege also of seeing the baby. And when she saw the baby, there was something within her that recognized what she was seeing, and she went out into the community and began spreading the news that hope was born. In a bleak and weary world, just as people were ready to give up hope, a baby was born, a king. Again, not to rule in kingdoms, but to rule in hearts. A king who came to be the savior, not just of the world, but of you and me. And those who were able to recognize who he was walked away more full of hope, because they realized that God was not dead, he was not asleep, he had not abandoned them or left them, but he was preparing his greatest work yet. And darkness would not have the last word. Even in the midst of strife, even in the midst of 2020, which has been a year of strife, the thing I want you to know and the thing I hope you will lean into this Christmas. Adults, if I could just ask you, and you don't have to answer out loud, but you know, we asked the kids earlier what they want for Christmas. My guess is if I were to ask you what you want for Christmas, some of you would say hope. Hope. It's been a hard year. But hope never fails. Hope in Christ never fails. And today, we have the privilege of recognizing and celebrating that hope. If you've never welcomed Christ into your life, into your heart, the good news is that he made himself available for all who were willing to receive him. The Apostle John said this, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And for those of us who know that hope, who already have received it, be encouraged to know that your hope is not in vain. Cling to what the Apostle Paul said in Romans. He said, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because God sent his Son to be with us, and he sent his Spirit to live in us, to give us his enduring hope. The words of the song we sang just a moment ago, all thy works with joy surround thee. Earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee, center of unbroken praise. Ever singing, march we onward, victors, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us sunward in the triumph song of life. Rejoice, rejoice. Our God is here with us. Emmanuel, our God is still with us. Let me pray. Father, what a gift to celebrate at the end of a hard year. At the end of a year where, quite frankly, so many of us in the room watching online, so many of us have wondered, where is our hope? So many of the things that we've relied on and put our hope in have let us down. And Father, I thank you that we have the privilege of remembering and knowing that we have a hope that's far greater than all of those things on earth. We have a hope in the one who came for us, whose birth we celebrate today. So, Father, we thank you for that, and we celebrate it. I pray in Jesus' incredible, matchless name. Amen.